comes in the name of the Lord. Will you join us in our Palm Sunday procession? You can be seated for just a moment before we continue singing, because we've got a couple things to share with you. Look through your bulletin and do find the announcement sheet. Read through that, and Kimberly will elaborate.
Okay, so today after second service in the conference room, we're going to have anyone that wants to help, we're going to be stuffing eggs for the Easter eggs and making the goodie bags for the Easter Bunny, so if you can stay after church a little bit in the conference room to help out, it's not that hard. Not in a rude way, just like, okay. Yeah, the more people there is, the less time it's going to take. And okay, also, we've had very little donations of candy and just mostly candy. And if you would like to donate some candy, we just need it by next Friday. But if you don't have time to go out and shop, we will take money donations because we need a lot more candy. So if you would like to donate or just, you know, go to the dollar store and just buy some candy, like a little pre-wrapped kind, that would be very helpful.
Thank you, Kimberly. Thank you for taking leadership in our Easter egg party, our Easter party. That's next Saturday at 10 o'clock, and that's going to be fun. Come and be a part of it. As I mentioned, look through your announcement sheet and notice community supper this Tuesday. We could use some help with that. Bring a dish or just come and serve or just come and be part of the community at supper. read about the revised core values and think about them, because we're going to want your input on those. And then I'm supposed to mention those that haven't been here on Easter. This cross over here is going to be transformed on Easter Sunday, and the way we transform it is bringing flowers and attaching them to the cross, and you'll see how that is if you haven't seen it before. So you're reminded to bring your flowers that you can attach to the cross next Sunday. And then we had a couple of prayer requests that were added. Mary Wiedenfield, her brother Otis Stillwell was injured on a four-wheeler this week, broken ribs and a lot of pain. So we want to keep him in prayer. Margie Odell is Shannon's friend from Kansas, whose father, she just found out her father's dying, and that could happen at any moment. And we ask for prayers for them. Are there any other prayer requests that we should be adding to our list this morning before our prayer time? Well, then let us continue in our morning worship, singing our praises to God. I invite you to stand as you're able as we sing our gathering music together.
Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. Jesus prepares to travel through the valley of heartache and loss.
We will follow Jesus for a while, creating hope in our hearts.
In the streets of Jerusalem, Jesus hears the cries of those who adore him.
We will shout Jesus' name for a while until we cry out, "Crucify him!"
Let us pray.
Holy God, architect of our grace, from your house we praise you. Your love is never taken from us. Your goodness is a constant in our lives. We worship you, Jesus Christ, sorrow of our salvation. You dare to listen to God instead of the cheers of the crowd and the cheers of your enemies. We walk with you. Holy Spirit, glory of God, you give us light so we might see the one who comes. You open our ears so we might hear the whispers of hope. You sustain the weary so we might journey through this week. We welcome you, God in community, holy in one. Hear us as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Nesta never stops working. Every day for the past 15 years, she has been bussing around her farm to grow nutritious foods to feed her family and to sell at the local market. Several years ago, Nesta lost her husband, and she is now the primary breadwinner for her family and 3 children. Over the past 3 years, Zimbabwe has been experiencing abnormal and extreme weather patterns, including long periods of drought. Nesta's face was downcast as she explained how she had not been able to harvest many vegetables because of the drought. Nesta made the difficult decision to use her savings to buy more seeds and more fertilizer for her farm. All for nothing, she said, as the harvest was still not enough to feed her family and generate money. Nesta and her friends were testing out different farming techniques when Nesta heard about a new conservation farming workshop through the Zimbabwe Synod of the United Congregational Church in Southern Africa. Through this workshop, Nesta learned how to use a drip irrigation system, which has been proven to help farms yield crops amid severe droughts. The Zimbabwe Synod also assisted Nesta in purchasing and installing her own drip irrigation system. Now the produce in Nesta's farm is growing again, and she will be producing a harvest similar to the ones before the droughts. Nesta is looking forward to feeding her family, praying for her children's school fees, giving to her local church, and buying a new outfit. This project of the Zimbabwe Synod of the UCCSA was supported by Global Ministries, and it's just one example of the ways that we abide with communities all over the world. Together, we are walking with sisters and brothers around the world who are seeking better lives for their families, communities, and countries. I now invite you to give generously as we worship God through the sharing of our gifts and offerings. You are supporting the life-giving and life-saving work of our church through regional and general ministries. Because of your support, disciples start new churches, strengthen ecumenical partnerships, combat evils like racism and human trafficking, bringing others to Christ, improve communities, and so much more. And there are envelopes provided for you in your bulletin if you would like to make a donation.
Your envelope looks like this. You still have time to fill it out before we get to you. When Jesus rode the donkey into Jerusalem, there were many people who were cheering and yelling Hosanna, waving branches in the air. But there were also many who came only to see the show. They had heard he was coming. It had sort of a carnival air about it. They were probably standing at the back of the crowd, just watching. If I had been there, I wonder where I would have been. I have no doubt that I would probably have been there. As a kid in the early 60s, I would stay up late so I could watch the satellites pass over, back in the day when it was reported on the news that we could see one. I am the person who would get up early to watch the space shuttles launch, the person who got up at 3:30 a.m. for the wedding of Prince Charles and Diana on TV, or stayed up very, very late to catch the latest news of some historical occurrence. And it goes on. Why? I don't know. Maybe to be part of the history. So I'm pretty sure that I would have been there as Jesus rode me into town. Afterwards, we had all stood around and talked about it for days. What we wouldn't know was that the beginning of the week that started off with such excitement and fun would have such darkness in the end. And yes, as Jesus was marched and dragged through the streets, I would probably have been there. Because of what happened that week, I am here. I have heard him call my name, and I know my sins are forgiven. So it is with gratitude that I come to this time of offering in our morning worship. I may not know where I would have been on First Palm Sunday almost 2,000 years ago, but I know where I am today. Let us receive our offering.
Lift up these joys and concerns or others
that are on your heart and your mind. And let us come together in God's presence, surrounded by God's love, as we pray together. Triumphant God, who comes to us as one who seeks and serves, lead us through the events of this Holy Week, that we may receive Christ anew in our lives and embody Christ's Spirit into the world. We pray that you enter our lives and our worship this morning as you did into Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday long ago. And we offer you this time of worship, or songs of praise, prayers, our offerings of thanksgiving, our reenacting that Last Supper with Jesus. We remember the final events of Jesus' life on earth, the great suffering he endured, and the great love which he portrayed for all humankind. We can never give enough thanks for the gift of your Son, Jesus. We can never do enough to deserve such a love. So we give you thanks the best way we know how. We thank you, O God. And we pray that you would use the words and music this morning to reach into our hearts in a new way. Help us to understand and to receive the gift of love that you have for each of us and for all your children. Help us to learn from Jesus' actions how to love you and love your people in a more faithful way. And help us to learn the importance of service. Help us to learn humility, to grow in our trust for you, to even accept risk when it is the appropriate way of faithfulness. And remind us of our capacity to deny and to crucify. In the midst of a violent world, Jesus stood for peace. Let us also stand for peace in our homes, our community, our nation, and around the world. We particularly pray for those who suffer from war and violence, and the many other challenges and violence of our world. We pray for those hurting among us and around us, and ask for healing, and that you would use us to bring healing as well. So we lift up our prayers for Janelle and Otis and Margie, for Cooper, Natalie, and Zaid, for Brenda and Avery, and Willow and Luna, the Rogers family, and for our sister churches near and far, part of this movement for wholeness in a very fragmented world. Oh God, help us to always celebrate your love and your amazing grace, and forgive us for our past feeble efforts. We pray in Jesus' name, and we continue to pray as he taught his disciples, to pray for your kingdom to come on earth. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
This is a really interesting time of the liturgical calendar to be a choir member, I think. And it's a lot of fun because we kind of get to go back and forth between the darkness of Lent and leading up, but then we get Palm Sunday and we get to have a little bit of fun. And then I'm going to plug on Thursday, for Monday, Thursday, we'll be doing a cantata that features some of the darker material that comes with Holy Week, and we're very excited. But for now, it's Palm Sunday, and we wanted to have some fun. I'm sure you've heard us sing this before, but we like it a lot, but we're going to worship Christ the King.
We're going to worship Christ the King. We're going to worship Christ the King. We're going to worship Christ the King and crown him the Lord of everything. We're going to worship Christ the King. We're going to worship Christ the King. We're gonna worship Christ the King and crown him the Lord of everything. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Lift up your everlasting doors. Lift up your heads and say amen. The King of the glory will come in.
Chapter 37, verses 1 through 14, the Old Testament prophet writing from Babylon in a dark time for Israel, but a time that we celebrate the answer this week. So I'll read the first verses, the odd verses, and I invite you to read with me on the even verses as we read about the valley of dry bones. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley that was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley. Bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, O sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, Prophesy to these bones and say to them, Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath into you, and you will come to life.
I will attach tendons to you, and make flesh come upon you, and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.
prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone.
I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath.
Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the Lord said, the sovereign Lord said, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain, that they may live.
So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life, and stood up on their feet, a vast army.
Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off.
Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. O my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring back the land of Israel.
Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them,
I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord.
I have done it, declares the Lord. Son of man, can these bones live? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be a blessing to you, O God. 2 hunters were out in the woods when one of them collapses. He doesn't seem to be breathing, and his eyes are glazed. The other guy takes out his phone and calls 911. He gasps, my friend is dead. What can I do? The operator says, calm down. I can help. First, let's make sure he's dead. There's a silence. And then a gunshot is heard. Back on the phone, the guy says, okay, now what? Well, folks, there is a lot of death in our world, isn't there? We don't need a gunshot to make sure. Just read the newspaper, watch the news, talk to your neighbors, listen to the conversations at the coffee shop, the grocery store, the kids' ball games, even here at church. What do you hear? How the world is a broken place. Kids don't mind. Husbands don't pay attention. Wives spend too much. Politicians lie. Preachers meddle. The poor are always with us. Wars kill. Poverty gets worse. Racism endures. Peace eludes. Hope fails. Jesus is crucified. The world is a broken place. Death is everywhere you look, and we don't need a gunshot to make sure. We live in a world of bones, dry, lifeless bones. But we're not alone. The people of Israel were led by God out of slavery and death in Egypt and into the promised land. They were given a land flowing with milk and honey, a new Garden of Eden. They were given a covenant of hospitality, radical hospitality, by God who loved them, nurtured them, gave them second chances, third chances, you name it. They were loved. They were asked to love God and love their neighbor in return, to share that radical hospitality, but they couldn't do it. They couldn't keep their eyes off of other gods, other priorities. They couldn't keep their hands off their neighbor's property, especially that of the poor, the widows, orphans, and outcasts, the powerless. They couldn't remain faithful to their covenant, to their God who loved them so much. It was God's love that took it all away, as promised in Deuteronomy. God sent in conquering armies to destroy their cities, their temple even, the symbol of God's constant presence with them. There was death all around them. When the leaders, the teachers, and the artisans were turned loose in Babylon to build new lives in exile, to work, to prosper, even to worship God, they could not do it. The temple, their homes, their promised land, their hopes and dreams were all gone. Their faith was dead, like dry, lifeless bones. No gunshot needed. Ezekiel was a prophet called by God in Babylon, in exile, called to speak a word of life to these people of Israel, the walking, talking dead. That's where our scripture this morning takes us, to Babylon. Sometime after 587 BC, when the Babylonian armies conquered Judah and carried God's people away into exile. It was in Babylon that we read, "The hand of the Lord came upon the prophet, and he brought him out by the Spirit of the Lord and set him down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones." These were dry bones, lifeless bones, bones of long dead armies, perhaps left on the ground to rot, to be picked clean by vultures and time. Ezekiel was surrounded by death. No gunshot needed. The prophet heard, "Son of man, can these bones live?" He said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.'" The imagery is powerful. The bones have special meaning. The Hebrew word petsem is used 8 times in the scripture. This is the word for bones that comes from the verb to be powerful. If bones are strong and firm, then the body and even the soul is considered strong. So special care was taken to bury bones in those days because bones reflected the deepest self and the essential self of the person. But these bones, long exposed and unattended, announced the spiritual tragedy that had fallen upon Israel. "Can these bones live?" God asks the prophet. Ezekiel prophesies, and he sees the bones come together, rattling and connected with sinews. Flesh covers the bones, but there is no life. Then God says, "Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, 'This is what the sovereign Lord says. Come, breath from the four winds, and breathe into those slain that they may live.'" The Hebrew word ruach is the word for spirit, as in God's spirit. But it is also the word for the wind and also for breath. For these bones to live, they will need breath. So Ezekiel prophesies to the breath, "Come, breath from the four winds, and breathe into these slain that they may live." And the bones come to life, connected with sinews, covered with skin, and filled with ruach, the breath of God's Spirit. God then identifies for Ezekiel that these bones he sees represent the whole house of Israel, the people in exile who have been saying, our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. My people, I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord. God's Spirit. With God's Spirit, anything is possible. Even for a people with no life. Even for a people with no hope. Even for a people surrounded with death, as we still are today. Where do you see death? Where in your life do you need the ruach, the breath of God's Spirit, to bring life to dry bones? Where do you need healing? The pain or disease in your body? The fear and loneliness? The blindness of your heart? The broken relationships? The misunderstandings? The barriers in your family? Your neighborhood? Your church? Your disconnect with the wider world around you, the creatures, even the wounded environment around us all, or the broken covenant with your God and the self-imposed exile that you feel, separating yourself from God's love. There is death in our very lives, isn't there? Do we have to wait until our body breaks down, until our family falls apart, until our friends walk away, before we seek the healing and the life of God's Spirit? Will you give up on your relationships, on your community, your church, your nation, because you've become cynical and unable to trust? Will you give up and consign our world to global climate change, to poverty, homelessness, AIDS, war, and terrorism, because you can see no hope for the dried bones of humanity or God's beautiful creation? Are you ready to fire the gun and pronounce it dead? No more life, no more breath, no more spirit, no more hope? God is asking each of us today, mortal, can these bones live? Is there any part of your body, your heart, your spirit, this church, this community, this nation, or this world that is so dried and lifeless that God's Spirit cannot breathe ruach into it and give it new life? The people of Israel said yes. Some of them wouldn't even come home when the exile was over. They abandoned their faith, their families, and their God. And God loved them anyway. And you know what? God still loves us anyway. We remember this week that God sent his Son to destroy the power of sin and death, the exile that we all experience, and give us all a second chance to bring us back home to God. And yet, we still, so many of us, still hold on to the death, unwilling or unable to breathe in that breath of life, of God's Spirit. You know why those Hebrew people did not return from exile? Because they gave up. They gave up hope. They gave up on God's promises for a nation of justice and mercy and humble relationship with God. They gave up on the temple, on the presence of God with the people, they gave up on God. They pulled the trigger and pronounced God dead. They replaced God with idols and other priorities. They replaced God with wealth and social status and power in this new land of freedom. They replaced God with comfort and self-indulgence, with laziness. Like those exiles in Babylon, we try to numb the spiritual pain by making life more comfortable. We work hard. We collect a lot of things. We buy houses, plant our roots, live quietly, and try to make Babylon as nice as we can. But however nicely we decorate it, Babylon is still not our home. And the day we deaden our longing for God and God's home is the day we spiritually die. And then the rest of us begins to slowly die from the inside out. But this is Palm Sunday. Jesus is riding into Jerusalem on his way to die, so we don't have to die spiritually. We don't have to settle for death. We certainly don't have to pull the trigger by giving up. God promised to bring those people back from Babylon. God promises to bring you back from your Babylon, from whatever death you are experiencing in your life. The Apostle Paul told the believers in Rome that the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. The church has always found its life not in what it sees today, but in that Spirit of God who raises dead hopes. The day we lose our ability to envision a better tomorrow is the day we deny that we really believe in Easter, that God can resurrect the dead. God is not done. God is breathing new life today, the life of God's Spirit, the Spirit of life. But it's up to you to believe in Easter, to prepare for Easter. It's up to us as a church to stand with the prophet Ezekiel and say, arise, arise from the heap of dry bones, of discarded dreams. Arise to discover that the Holy Spirit is breathing life back into you. Arise to live with new hope. Arise to life in the Spirit, because the world is dying for you to live in the Spirit, for the church to live in the Spirit and share that vision, to believe that God is not done with us. Yes, these bones can live. Will you pray with me? We thank you, O God, for your promises. And not just your promises, but how you fulfill your promises and how you fulfilled your main promise to bring all people and all of creation back into relationship with you through forgiveness of sins, through calling us back from our Babylon. Oh God, walk with us this week as we walk with Jesus, as he shows us his final message, as he shows us how much you love us, how far you will go to show us that love and to bring us back to you. Walk with us as we walk back to you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our invitation hymn this morning is All Glory, Laud, and Honor. Another great Palm Sunday hymn for us to sing our praises. If there's anyone here today who's ready to proclaim that this vision or parable of Ezekiel has truly been accomplished through Jesus for the Jews, for the whole world, and for you and me, that God has restored all the world into right relationship with God through Jesus, the true Lord and Savior of the world. And if you are ready to live in this right relationship and help this church to encourage others to do the same through Jesus, then I invite you to come forward as we sing this hymn. I invite you to stand as you're able. And let us sing our praises to God.
Salvation is possible even when it would logically seem to be too late. In the prophet's own time, it was exile from Judah that was the insurmountable problem and which led to despair among the people. In his vision, we see the power of God calling a people to life, a people who had lost hope of return to their home. Their renewed faith spurred them to action, and God used their proactivity as an instrument of his will to bring about what seemed impossible, their return home. The plight of those exiled to Babylon reminds me of the way generations of people suffered under the oppression of apartheid for nearly 50 years in South Africa. Through sacrifice and faith in the face of violence and injustice, a miracle took place. Something that appeared impossible came to pass as President F.W. de Klerk and his government dismantled the apartheid system and introduced universal suffrage, eventually leading to an end to the white minority government in South Africa. As we come now to the Lord's table on this Palm Sunday, filled with hope, let us be revitalized and our faith renewed by remembering the impossible thing our Savior did for us. That though he suffered and died, he rose again, and with his sacrifice, saved humanity from our sins, perhaps the most impossible miracle of all. With that, he made us a people of hope. Will you join with me in our affirmation of faith?
I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, Savior and Lord of God.
Join me in prayer. Lord, breathe into our bones the hope we need to continue to seek your will for us. Give us the faith to know that you can do all things, even those deemed to be impossible. Bless our actions and words that they may bring healing to those in need and understanding to those who are lost. Make us the bearers of your light, that it may fill the lives of all.
To be our exodus from sin back into relationship with God. And he did that by taking the elements from the Passover feast, a loaf of bread. He gave thanks to God, and he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Similarly, at the end of the supper, Jesus poured out a cup and gave it to the disciples. And he said, "This cup represents the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of this cup, do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we remember Christ's death for our sins and the sins of the world until he comes again. Come to this table and remember.
Thank you.
But Jesus